intro and then you'll be ready in 5 minutes or so?
Yeah, I'm ready in it.
Okay, anything. So we'll see.
Okay, good morning. Welcome to the Fast Path Workshop. This is actually our fifth installment of Fast Path. The original was in 2012. We skipped a couple of years, but here we are. And I'm very glad to see this good attendance, and I think we've got a really strong, interesting program with a lot of interesting speakers and papers, so I hope you find it an enjoyable and useful day. Just a little bit in terms of background, we have several co-organizers. Sarah Sura is sitting back there at the table, one of the program co-chairs. Our other program co-chair, unfortunately, ran into visa difficulties and couldn't make it. That's Harjot today, and so he was really hoping to come and spend part of Fast Path all along, so we're disappointed that he can't make it, but we're also thankful to Michael Papa Michael, who's the overall workshops and tutorials chair for ISPAS, and that has been very helpful to us, and I'm sure the other tutorials and workshops here in terms of getting everything going. As you probably saw in the schedule, and we have printed schedules for those of you who are interested up here. We have a slight change compared to what we were expecting due to flooding in Dublin. Our originally scheduled first speaker, David Gregg, is slightly delayed. So Christoph, who was originally slated to be our second speaker, is very graciously at the last minute agreed to step up and go first. So we'll be very much looking forward to his talk. We will have two coffee breaks and a lunch break. There's coffee outside that's periodically replenished if you want to go out during your talk. Please do so quietly, but it should be available all day. Lunch will also be provided. It will be fairly light today, unlike the next 2 days if you're staying for the full conference with the sandwiches, finger food, that sort of thing. So, but it will be provided. You don't need to go out to a separate restaurant or something like that. And with that, I'd like to introduce Christoph Dubach, who's our first invited speaker. Christoph is a lecturer, he's an associate professor at the University of Edinburgh. He's been there, I believe, since 2012. He received his PhD in 2009, also from the University of Edinburgh. And it was named the best PhD dissertation that year in the entire UK. Very, very impressive, I think. And as a matter of fact, looking at his title, which I happen to have here, I think he was one of the real pioneers in the area of this workshop. And more generally, his dissertation was using machine learning to efficiently explore the architecture compiler co-design space. And there's been a lot of work in that area and a much broader set of works, and I think we're going to get up some of that. So welcome, Christoph.
Thank you, Eric, for a nice introduction. So my talk today is maybe a little bit off the main topic of this workshop, but I'll try as much as I can to fit within the scope. So it's about high-performance compression code generation with Lyft using Rewrite. So this is work we started about 4 years ago in my group, and since then this project has a bit grown. And the goal here for us is to ask the question, how do you generate very efficient code for modern parallel accelerators such as GPUs or FPGAs in a perfectly affordable way so that you don't have to rewrite your code every single time your hardware changes. And one of our use case is how do we do that efficiently for machine learning algorithms such as neural networks. So just to manage expectation, unfortunately, I was hoping to have some nice fresh result to show you about how this actually works for neural network, but we are not quite yet there with this work, but I will give you some very preliminary results that shows that there is hope for this work to work well for convolution neural network in particular. Feel free to interrupt me at any time. I think it's a workshop, so I like this, it's more interactive than just question at the end that works with everyone. Okay, so the first question is, what is this performance vulnerability challenge, and why is that important? So if we look at the top 500 supercomputer in the world, the ranked by top 500 list, we see that about 20% nowadays, so 20% of these systems have parallel accelerators in them, one way or another. This is a listing from December 2017, so just a few months ago. And what we see is that the trend is increasing, and we count as parallel accelerators things like GPUs, Intel Xeon Phi, but also there is the IBM Cell processor here, which I would classify as, you know, a core CPU with some parallel acceleration units on the side. And nowadays we see again reemergence of this type of system with like the Sunway processor from the Chinese Academy of Science, I think. Where they have again a kind of model where you have a core CPU with around it some little parallax acceleration units. So what is the problem with that? Is that it's extremely difficult to program this system, and it's even harder to achieve high performance. So first of all, you have to figure out how do you program it, then how do you get performance, and now it's a nightmare if you're trying to move and migrate your code from one of these systems to another, or if tomorrow a new type of accelerator emerges, you have to restart from scratch. This is the performance portability problem. If we look
Sorry, since you wanted to be interrupted, do the systems with accelerators tend to cluster near the top of the top 500, or are they spread throughout, or near the bottom? Or?
So they are spread throughout. However, I think the top three have parallel accelerators. So I think it's more a matter of the if you want to be number one, you have to have them. I mean, at least as far as I could tell, when I look back in time, the number one always had in the last couple of years of parallel accelerator. Thank you. So the big question is, how hard is it to program these machines? And I will take a very simple example. How would you summon an array? Okay? And if you're trying to just summon an array, which is not such an exciting application, but just to illustrate the difficulty in doing that, you could use your favorite language, C, for instance, where you declare a for loop, an accumulator, and everybody knows this code by heart. But actually, if you want to do it really, really well, and you have, let's say, a GPU in your system, this is the type of parallel code you have to write. So for those of you who don't know what this is, just out of curiosity, who doesn't know OpenCL or CUDA? Who is familiar with CUDA and OpenCL? Okay, so a few people. But this is the horrible code that you have to write by hand, which talks about how you're mapping your problem to multiple threads, how you do synchronization, how you exploit shared memory, be able to do a very quick tree-based reduction when you want to sum your arrays in parallel. And this is the type of code you have to write for that one specific GPU, the NVIDIA Tesla GPU in this case. And in addition, if you write that horrible code, which might take actually, although it's not that many lines, but it might take maybe a week, performance is actually not portable. So if you run this on an NVIDIA GPU, well, that's the best. So one is, what's the best performance you can achieve? So this is the performance you get. If you migrate to an AMD GPU, for instance, you will see that you are only at 25% of the maximum performance that your machine can give you, based on another implementation that is known, that is the best you could code for AMD. And if things are even worse, if you try to run that on the ARM Mali GPU, which is an embedded mobile GPU that you find in mobile phones, like this one here, it just doesn't run. Because the kernel before uses some tricks. It uses some low-level hardware details to make an optimization, to remove synchronization when you have less than 32 threads running on the GPU. But this is not a model that works on ARM Mali GPU, so it will just simply not run here, not give it the right answer. So the big question is, how do we actually program these machines? What do application developers do? So this is the kernel landscape. You have the applications on the top here, and they are sitting directly on low-level device-specific interfaces, such as OpenCL, OpenMP, or maybe VHDL, if you have an FPGA in your system. This is the case, for instance, Microsoft has this Catapult project, where actually they really write these machine learning algorithms directly by hand in VHDL with about 50 hardware engineers. And then this interface allows you to target these various types of parallel accelerators. So what we would like to do instead, and this is what all good computer scientists would tell you, is create abstractions later. And this is basically the direction we're going into, where we're going to have some domain-specific languages, for instance, specialized for image processing on neural network or graph analytics. And then the idea is, can we target maybe a kind of generic data parallel intermediate representation that then you could feed that into a performance portable compiler that will be able to generate this low-level code here that no one wants really to write. So this is what I think we need, and I'm not the only one to advocate for this, but I think this is the direction we're going in. So here what I propose is basically we have this project called LIFT, where we're trying to do exactly this, and we basically stop at this boundary here. We ask the question, what should this data paradigm right language looks like, and how do we develop port-a-purpose foreign compiler technology? And Lyft, it's in the name, it's a bottom-up approach, okay? We're trying to lift the programming abstraction without losing performance. So our starting point is always a very well-optimized program down there, written in one of the low-level languages, and we ask the question, okay, that's the best I know, I can do by hand, how can I abstract the programming model, but while I keep the performance? So the current work, this is what I'm gonna talk about in this presentation, is basically this path here, where we're going down to OpenCL, that was one of our first use cases, for the purpose of programming GPUs. So if we now have a look at the evolution of programming and what people have done in the past, we see that we all start with assembly programming, okay, and then compilers came along and we're like, yeah, we can now do structured programming. So basically, we have high-level construct. I mean, we can debate whether they're high-level or not, but we have constructs of for loop, while loops, if then else, that basically abstract away control flow, and that makes life a little bit easier. So this is the same program as before. This is just summing an array, okay? This is the assembly instruction. This is in C. And now we're moving up to more an algorithmic style of programming, where you're having algorithmic primitives or building blocks, such as reduce. And then you just say, hey, I want to reduce this array using the sum operator, the addition operator, starting with the initial element zero. And this is all what you need to do to describe your algorithm. These are called algorithmic patterns in some community, or algorithmic skeleton. So what we see here is that we start from a very low-level style of programming, but it's very generic. You can do everything you want with the machine, but it's very hard to use. It's hard to optimize automatically. If you were to feed assembly into a compiler, you would have a hard time re-optimizing this. And all the way at the bottom here, you go to a much higher level. Maybe there are some design points in your machine you can't reach, but it's much easier to use and it's much easier to program. So this is basically a general trend that I see in how to program machines. What are these algorithmic patterns? So they are small building blocks, such as map and reduce, that everybody is familiar if you've heard of the map reduce framework from Google. It's the idea that you can do the red circle of represent operations here. So it's the idea that you have data in blue, and you can apply the same operation to every element of your data that results in a new set or collection of data. Reductions is the ability to chain operations, kind of carrying it around a state. So for instance, if you're going to sum an array, this is what you do. You start with zero, and then at each operation, you just add the next element in your array. You have some operation to talk about data reorganization, such as gather or scatters that allows you to move data around based on some functions that basically maps the original iteration space to a new one. You have the ability to partition your data, maybe. And you have more complex algorithmic patterns, such as stencil propagation, which are the actual one that matters if you want to implement convolution. And we will see that later on in the talk. So what is good about this programming abstraction is that as far as the programmer is concerned, this is what he has in mind. He's saying, I'm doing a reduction, this is the operation, this is what is happening in my head. But as far as the implementation is concerned, you could do something different. So if you want a very fast reduction, and your operator is associative and commutative, you can do a tree-based reduction. Actually, you just need associativity for tree-based reduction. But if you have commutativity, you can do more nice tricks. And this means that we can separate the programming abstraction from the actual implementation. So you could program with reduce, and under the hood, this is how the reduction is going to execute. So what about deep neural network, which is very trendy nowadays? So deep neural network have several layers, and many of these layers could be convolutions, for instance. And this is how people typically handle deep neural network for the purpose of image recognition. So first, if we look at traditional neural networks, such as GoogleNet, ResNet, or BGG, it is well known that about 80% of the time, it's actually spent in a convolution layer. And these are numbers that we gather, again, ourselves to double check, and we saw that on a mobile ARM CPU, this is the result we get when we run Cafe on a CPU. And the classical way to do that, at least in Cafe, is basically to express convolution as matrix multiplication. And the idea here is that you can use the standard BLAST interface. So BLAST stands for linear algebra I forgot what the BNAS stands for, but basically, this is a well-known API for doing linear algebra operations, such as matrix multiplication. And you can transform this convolution problem into matrix multiplication and do some pre-processing of your data. In general, it's called this into call that process, take this image and basically duplicate data to then transform this convolution operation to matrix multiplication. And why do you want to do that? Well, because matrix multiplication is a well-known problem, and the HPC community has spent decades literally tuning that particular application or algorithm, okay? So the idea is that if you can remap your program into matrix multiplication, you should be good. However, here we hit again a problem that if you do not have that library or that implementation of matrix multiplication for your device, you're gonna again be stuck with maybe a low performance or not as high as you would expect. So if you come back to our high performance code, one question you could ask is how do we get to that crazy implementation here? What does the human do? And actually what the human do, the process is usually you start with a very naive version, and little by little you iterate that version, and step by step you make it more optimized by reading a kind of guidebook or recipe of telling you, hi, you're targeting this hardware, you should probably vectorize your loads or vectorize your operation, first thing you should do. Oh, there is shared memory, yeah, make use of that, that's gonna be better. And humans basically know good set of patterns of optimization, and when you look at code, you say, hey, I could here apply this well-known optimization and I might get performance improvement. But the big question is, how do we get there automatically? Can we do something to generate this code automatically? This is what we're gonna see. So this is what the Lyft approach is about. How do you generate this high performance type of code in an automatic manner? So to do this, we propose to start from a small set of primitives, which are functional. That means they don't have any side effects. They are very, very simple. And these ones are map, zip, reduce, which are commonly used in functional programming languages. So map simply apply the same function to each element of an array and return the resulting array. Zip takes two arrays and create pairs. You could think of this is a bit like taking struct of array versus array of struct. So zip cannot do this transformation. Reduce just apply a binary operator to each element, for instance an addition to sum all the elements in your array. Split and join are simply some data layout transformation that allows you to break down an array into subarrays or join back the results. So they just create, if you like, virtually extra dimension in your array. Then we have some nice little function like iterate, which is the iterative function in the mathematical sense, where you apply a function on itself multiple times, and some reordering or permutation function that allows you to swap the position of the elements if you like. And the key about these primitives is that they focus on what you want to do rather than how you want to do it. And again, that comes back to these algorithmic patterns. Now, if we look back at this code, it's going to be a bit of a big jump. But what I just want to give you the feeling here is that we can take that code and actually abstract it away by representing it as a sequence of these operation that I've shown you just earlier. So for instance, we have an OpenCL code here that has to do with which thread does what work. And actually, we can abstract this away by using the split, reorder, and map function over there, which tells us I'm going to split the data in chunks of 256. I'm going to do a reordering of this data somehow. This is to guarantee memory coalescing. And then I'm going to map work groups to each of this chunk of 256. This is how you should read this. I won't go into the detail of what's on the right, but just to give you a kind of feeling of an intuition. Then we have this other part here. What is this code doing? It's actually accumulating, reading all the global memory up to a chunk of 256 and moving that to local memory. And while you do that, you do one addition. And this is basically this code here. So there is an addition I mentioned, so that's why there is a reduction over there. And then there is a little bit of pattern to tell you move that to local memory. We might be zipping the inputs because what you want to do is take two sets of inputs, put them, build the pairs, and then sum all the elements in the pairs. And this is where you see the addition here. So again, let's not look at detail. It's just the intuition that we can represent each of these bits of code by a little bit of primitives over there. Here, this is code that simply do a tree-based reduction. So this is where this iterate construct comes in that I mentioned earlier. You're basically iterating a process which is, please take my array, sum all the pairs, now you have a new array, repeat, okay? And this has just been unrolled. That's why we have two statements here. And this here thing is almost the same. It's again an iteration, except there's no barriers. You notice here there are barriers, here they're gone. Why is that? Because you know at this stage you have less than 32 threads on it. And you know that the GP model tells you that 32 threads are always implicitly synchronized, so you don't need any synchronization. And this is reflected in this on the right-hand side of the abstraction that over there we were saying, please map this computation over the local threads. But now we say, please map that onto a warp. Because we know that when we want cogeneration, if we see map warp, we don't have to emit a barrier. So it's maybe a little bit too much detail, but for those of you who have an idea of OpenCL or CUDA, I hope that this gives you an intuition of what Lyft does. And at the very end, this is just a final copy to bring back the data into global memory. Okay, so a couple of observations here. What I'm trying to give you as an intuition here is that we can express this implementation as a composition of simple primitives. Okay, and this primitive has the same one as the one you would use to program in the first place, they map, zip, reduce. And we can even express very complex optimization. So this kernel I've shown you on the left, I can express it with this functional IR, and I can give this functional IR to my code generator, and it will generate me back the kernel we've seen before. It might be a little bit different, but it's doing the same operation on the machine. Yeah.
As on the previous slide, the last part you showed about the iterate, and knowing that if you have less than 32 threads, you can do this optimization. That seems like it works potentially in opposition to portability. And what if I want to run this on an FPGA or some specialized ASIC accelerator, which doesn't necessarily have that same functionality as the GPU?
Absolutely. And this is the key reason why I was telling you this code does not run on an ARM Mali GPU, on the mobile phone. Because on the ARM Mali GPU, the hardware doesn't synchronize these threads. They're all independent. So that's actually incorrect on this hardware. So the key here will be to figure out, well, this version on the left or on the right only works for a specific machine. So how do I create versions that will work on others, and how do I explore that space? And I will give you some hints about this.
Okay, but my question, the iterate seems like it's specifically thinking of a GPU. When I write the Lyft code, or is that not?
You could think of it for GPU, but you can also do it on the host side. So for instance, you can imagine an iterative process where you're iterating on the host, you have an FPGA, and you keep sending data to the FPGA, it gives you back the result, and then you manipulate the data and you send it back and forth. So it doesn't have to execute necessarily on the device.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I have another question. Maybe I might not have some background on GPUs, but the reason why you claim that some part of code would run better on NVIDIA GPUs compared to ARM, is it because of the architecture limitations of the AMD GPUs, or is it because the way software is written is different?
It's the way the software is written. So I'm not claiming ARM is better than NVIDIA.
AMD and NVIDIA.
So I was not claiming one was faster than the other. I was just saying that specific implementation of this algorithm, if you run this one on that machine, it's suboptimal, but it's optimal for the other machine.
And it works the other way also, right?
It works the other way around. If I take the best AMD version and run it on AMD, on NVIDIA, it's not going to be as great. We tend to see that actually NVIDIA hardware are much more forgiving. So if you run the best AMD optimized version on NVIDIA, you won't get such bad results on NVIDIA. But if you do the other way around, it's terrible. And the one reason I believe is NVIDIA has large caches in the GPU. So even if you don't get your reuse properly in software, the hardware will be there to save you.
So at the software level, what is the highest thing that is limiting here, like thread synchronization or anything?
Use of shared memory, avoiding synchronization if you can, vectorizing your code if you have a vector architecture, like our mobile GPU. Using built-in functions, if they're available in hardware. And I will give an example of that later in the talk. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about how you came to the choice of the IR from this? Because I think you mentioned that they're based on algorithmic patterns.
Yeah.
But when I look at these, some of them are algorithmic and some of them are more architecture.
Correct. So I'll give some more clue a bit later. So I think the idea is that there are two sets of these primitives. One are the abstraction used to program, which reappear in the low-level description of your algorithm. And the other one are hardware-specific. And I will again highlight that mid-decade the talk. And if I don't answer, if my talk doesn't answer your question, feel free to ask it again. Okay? So I'll just move on. There's no other question for that? Okay. So the big question becomes, okay, so if I have this representation of my low-level implementation, or at still a high level, but it's much lower level now than if you just say reduce, how do I go from left to right? Okay? And this is what we do in Lyft with rewrite rules. So I'll give you some example of what are rewrites. So rewrites are basically probably correct transformation that you're allowed to do on your IR or on your expression. And they basically express algorithmic or optimization choices that you may have. So for instance, here is a simple one. We call it the split join rule, which tells you if you have this operation map function f, so that means, let's say, map plus 2 on each element of your array, what you're allowed to do, you're allowed to split the array into chunks, map for each chunk, map the original function for each element in the chunk, and then join back the result. That's divide and conquer. Okay? And you can prove that this is always correct, no matter what f does. As long as f has no side effect. Right? We are in a functional settings, so that's no problem. Another simple one, map fusion. This is telling you that this is, should I mention the notation, this is a data flow notation. You just say the output of the previous function flows in as an input to the next one. So if I'm doing plus 2, map plus 2, followed by map plus 3, I can do that in one step, okay, and avoid an intermediate buffer here. And this means that I can always fuse these two functions into a single map. Now the reduction rules are a little bit more interesting because this is really the key here to understand how we go from that reduce plus to this horrible complex expression I've shown you earlier. And the idea here is to say, okay, if you're doing a reduction, what you can do, you can partially reduce your result. That means you're reducing a bit, but you may be left over with some things that you have to reduce. And then you finally reduce. And if you look at what you can do is reduce partial, which is on the left-hand side here, you can say, well, if I try to reduce partially something, I'm allowed to reorder and then reduce partially, as long as my operator is commutative. I can have a kind of direct and conquer approach. I'm allowed to split my data, map for each chunk this partial reduction, and then join back the result. This is basically why it's a partial reduction, because now you're left with one element for each chunk. But this is fine, because at the end you always reduce. I'm allowed to iterate a partial reduction. So let's imagine I have a partial reduction that cuts my array in half each time. Well, I can iteratively apply this operation until I have one element left, or maybe two, or maybe four. Again, it doesn't matter because at the end we always reduce. Or I can just say, well, I'm going to just run a sequential reduction over my data. And the idea, this is similar to a rewrite rule of the regression rule that you find in grammars. If you study parsers, you've written a parser, we're going to start from the left-hand side here, which is a non-terminal, and we're going to apply these rules until we reach just a sequence of non-terminals. And that's going to give us a program that we know is equivalent to the original one, the starting point. So let's see that in practice. How does it work? So if we look at matrix multiplication, which is one of the core algorithms that we use for doing convolution, we can express it in our language in this style of saying, okay, I'm going to map over the row of A, so that's the row of A, I'm going to map over the column of B. I'm just omitting here the fact that I've transposed B, it's a small detail. And then what do? I zip a row of A and a column of B to create pairs of elements. Then I multiply these pairwise, and finally I reduce by summing. And that's the entry point to the compiler. And now let's see what we can do with these rules I've shown you earlier on. So we can take that expression there. We could create a very dumb code generator that says whenever you see map, emit a for loop. Whenever you see reduce, emit a for loop, and so on. And if we do that, we could generate that C code here. Each for loop corresponds to basically one of these map or reduce constructs. And I think that should make sense. I hope I haven't lost anyone here, okay? And now what we can do, we can say, well, I know of a way to transform this expression on the left-hand side with one of these rules, for instance, this split join rule. So I'm gonna take the outer map, for instance, and I'm gonna apply this rule, and now I've rewritten the expression on the left into an equivalent form. And I can again give that to the code gen, and the effect would be that now I've created a tile. I've tiled that loop here, where I have now the outermost loop. I have I've nested another one inside. Okay, so that's the effect. I can keep going, and I can apply a rule to interchange maps. I haven't shown you all the rules we have, but we have about 40 rules. I can create, again, apply a split join rule. I can interchange again. I can do a few more of these steps. And I can come up with this expression here for matrix specification, which is a tiled version of matrix multiplication. If I give that to the code gen, I get this C code over there. Which is, why do we want to tile? Because it increases reusage, okay? So that's why we may want to follow this path. Now, I can start to talk about, at the moment, this is purely algorithmic. All the patterns I'm using on the left side are just zip, reduce, and map, more or less. But I can start to talk about architecture-specific things now. For instance, vectorization. So I can apply a rule here, and I should have shown you the rule. But basically, if you look at this part of the code here, what has happened is that I took this map, I think it's this one, the map merged here. And I have a rule that tells me if you try to map an operator in parallel, and this operator is one of the well-known operators that you can vectorize, what I'm allowed to do is actually map a vectorized form of the operator, word 4. But before and after, what I have to do is I have to typecast my data somehow. So this is where this bit called as vector comes in. They are typecast to say, now let's reinterpret this data as a vector. And once the operation is finished, reinterpret the result as a scalar, because that's what the original expression expects, that you compute on scalar. And if we give that to the code generator, this time the code gen will emit some vload and vstore and apply and call the mult4, the vectorized form of the operator. Does it make sense? And now this expression becomes more specific to the horror you have in mind, because now we have vectorized the multiplication here. And the rules. Yep.
So what is your objective function to know which of these reductions to apply and what order?
So we do not have an objective function. The objective function is performance, the faster the better. And what we do, we randomly search the space. And then we show results of doing that in a few seconds. So here, I'm just interested in the problem of, can I reconstruct a low-level C implementation that the programmer could have written by hand? And then we will look at the problem, what do I do with this? Another thing I can start mapping parallelism. So these maps over there, they're quite generic. You just tell me, apply this function. But now I can be more specific, and I can turn them into maybe map globals. That means please use the global execution space of threads. That means use the threads to compute this map. And the result on the right-hand side is that two for loops have disappeared, and instead we replace the iteration variable with the thread ID. OpenCL has and CUDA has a model similar to MPI, where each thread knows its ID and use that to basically index the data. I can also start to talk about accumulating in private memory, so that means registers usually, when you talk about private memory in OpenCL, by doing a transformation which is moving the data to private memory. This is this pattern we have here. And we do the opposite down there to global. We have a rule that tells us when you put to private, you should move back to global memory afterwards. And the result is that we suddenly have variables that appears here if you give that to the code generator. And if we look at this version, this is actually the fastest matrix multiplication we found on an ARM Mali GPU. Okay. It's quite complex, but we get there by following a set of steps of correct rewrite rules. So now, what do we do with the system? Well, we start with an expression like this one here, and we go and more or less randomly explore the space. So we generated 500,000 different OpenCL kernels, starting from this input here in the compiler, but just following different derivations. We have some heuristic to make sure that we don't go too deep in one side of the search tree if the performance is bad. For instance, what we might do is we may start at the high level with a few rewrites. Once we have fixed these ones, we go down to some random descent, maybe 50 or 100. If we realize that this part of the tree always is the bad performance, we just ignore it and prune it. We check that we don't apply the same rule too often, because some of these rules are recursive, so you could apply them in an infinite amount of time, and so on and so forth. And this is the result that we get if we actually run this on an NVIDIA GPU here for 4 different input sizes. This is results in gigaflops, so higher is better. And the blue bar is what happens, what is the best performance we get with this, out of this 500,000 kernel we generated using rewrite. And the yellow bar is the best performance we get when you use the state-of-the-art open source OpenCL implementation of matrix multiplication, which is called CL Blast. And we plugged in the CL Tune auto-tuner to try to tune the parameters of the kernel that the CL Blast has, okay? Which is kind of state-of-the-art, again, OpenCL version for matrix multiplication. And what we see here is that we are pretty good. We almost match the performance of that CL Blast implementation has been written by hand. If we move to AMD GPU, we notice that we're always as good, if not better, than this yellow implementation. Okay? The reason here is that this yellow implementation was first designed for NVIDIA, and then they say, oh, let's extend it to work with AMD hardware as well and add some optimization. And you can see already that they've lost a little bit, or at least we won a bit better, just because they had in mind an NVIDIA hardware when they brought that version by hand. And now, if you go to an ARM-Mali GPU, that's the next slide, the yellow bar is terrible, okay? So this is the same CLBAS code, which has been written for desktop class GPU, and now we run that on mobile GPU, which is very different. And we see here that Lyft, the black bar, is able to outperform this CL implementation. If you're wondering about the Lightblue implementation, that's the best handwritten implementation of Matrix Communication we could find for ARM Mali GPU, written by an ARM engineer. So we got ourselves the toughest reference point here. And this shows basically that we can achieve this performance portability. Now, when we actually started this work, and we started also as well with desktop class GPU in mind, when we migrated to the ARM Mali GPU, actually this slide is a bit of a lie, because the first time we tried our same search strategy, same thing, on ARM, we only got to 10 gigaflops. Okay? And here I'm showing you 14. So what's wrong here? So we look at the code that human wrote and realize that the human make use of a dot built-in function, because the ARM Mali GPU most likely has a functional unit to the dot product of four floats directly in one cycle. And when we generated our code, although we generated vectorized form of the code, the ARM OpenCL compiler will not pick up this code and use the built-in dot product function. So what we did, we just added one rule to our system, which exploit this fact that we could use the dot built-in function. And this rule says that if you see zip these two vectors, map a vectorized form of application, and then reduce, this is equivalent to calling the dot built-in function. And we just add that dot built-in function to the code gen, we generate the dot built-in in OpenCL, and then we rerun our exploration, and we get an improvement of to about 14 gigaflops. So although the first time around we did not get the best performance, now we added that one rule, and you could imagine that if for each of these specific hardware units you have in your hardware, you add one such a rule, we should be able to reach this point in the space and get the performance. So this shows that there is no need to modify the original algorithm or program, and we can get performance portability by simply adding a rule to the compiler, rerunning the search, and we were done in this case. So, I talked a lot about matrix multiplication, as I mentioned, because it's used a lot for doing convolution in most of the machine learning framework. But there's a problem. The problem is that you require a much larger input matrix when you want to do it with matrix multiplication. So I won't go into the detail, but basically, if k is the size of the kernel, the width of the kernel, we need the square of k more data reads than if you were to not use matrix multiplication to implement your convolution. And the idea here, if you can think of it, is that what you're going to be doing to use matrix multiplication is that your kernels basically are shifting around the image. And that means that if you want to do it with matrix multiplication, what you have to do is you have to first read the image and duplicate each of the data the kernel will read. And once you have duplicated that, you can call matrix multiplication by creating a column, transforming your square kernel into a column, and do similarly for the tiles you have created, and then you can just multiply them with matrix multiplication. There is more details on that. There is a paper actually from David Craig, he's over there, that explained this problem very well. It's just that it was published last year. So what we want to do, and unfortunately I won't have results really to show you, but I will show you for some other applications that are similar what the performance we get. We want to directly express a convolution, so that we do not have to do this duplication of data in memory, which will result in less memory accesses, potentially input-specific implementation. So neural network, the nice thing is, well, it's not a nice thing, but these many layers, the size and shape of the data that you have might be very different from one layer to the next. But it's always the same application you're running. So you could potentially hard-code your matrix multiplication kernel or convolution kernel for specific input sizes. And we can do that with our framework. Before I talk about how we encode convolution, I want to do a detour back with stencil computation.
Sorry, so your system realizes that if you have frequency to time domain transform and vice versa, convolution goes to matrix multiply? Is that the sort of...
No, so our system, we just give it please do implement matrix communication, and then we can take CAFE, for instance, that rely on CLBLAS, OpenBLAS, and replace the implementation with ours.
Okay.
That's what we can do. So a system doesn't realize that you can play this trick. Although we could maybe look into that, how we could automate that. But at this stage, we're just focusing on matrix communication. And now we want to see how can we do convolution rather than matrix communication directly. So to express convolution, what we're going to do is, convolution is actually a special case of stencil computation. So what is a stencil computation? In a very simplistic way, it's you're basically updating the position. You have a grid, one-dimensional grid or 2D grid, it doesn't matter. And the point is that you're updating each point in the grid as a function of the neighbors in the grid. Okay? So in 1D, that looks a bit like this. You have this blue array as an input, and you apply the same function that takes triplets of elements, for instance, and produce one output for each of these triplets. I hope that makes sense. And this is basically the basic pattern for convolution. So what we do with Lyft is we have this slide primitive that we introduce, which is the idea that you can create a moving window for your data in one dimension. And why do we do this? Because we can express this stencil computation reusing the patterns we already have, the map pattern, for instance. So this slide pattern is just going to be a kind of data layout transformation, if you like. We're going to say, OK, I can take this initial array, I can slide it. That creates little chunks of an array of neighbors. And then I can map for each of these neighbors my function f, which will be my stencil, or my kernel that I'm trying to convolve, and I get back one output. The nice thing, and I won't go into detail in this talk, is that this works in 2D as well. So we have a paper at CGO this year that shows that it's just focused on stencil, and it shows you how you can combine this slide multiple times to basically do it in 2D. And why do we want to do that? Because now we can leverage all the existing rewrite rules that we already have, that we already know. Because we have a gate map field that appears, so I don't have to explain how to do a stencil in parallel, because just expressing stencil as a composition of slide and map, it will be enough for a compiler to parallelize this. So that's the bottom line. If we do it this way, we don't have any changes in the compiler besides introducing that new slide primitive. And actually, we also introduce a pad primitive to explain what happens at the boundary, but that's a bit of a detail. And we had to add just one extra rewrite rule that explained what you can do with this slide primitive, how does it interact with the other pattern. And there is more detail in this CGO paper we had a month or two ago at Vienna. And this is basically the result that we get if we do stencil computation. So this is on NVIDIA platform, AMD, and ARM. We have two bars. We have the Lyft generated implementation and the reference point written by a human. And this is a couple of benchmarks down there, ranging from acoustic simulation to a simple stencil 2D, which is kind of like a convolution, if you like. And what we see is that we are on par, and quite often we actually beat the handwritten implementation. So higher is better, the performance here. And we also noticed some interesting point, for instance, on AMD, this hotspot 2D benchmark, we're able to be 10 times faster than what the handwritten implementation is. Okay? Because we found a point in the space that is much better for this type of hardware. In an ARM-managed GPU, that's interesting, we're usually much faster by maybe 2x for some of these applications than the handwritten implementation. And it's again because this handwritten implementation has not necessarily been written for the ARM-managed GPU. Why do I keep talking, by the way, about mobile GPU? Well, because that's probably one of the second best use cases, the device used for machine learning, right? If you think you're having image recognitions and all that on your phone, and in the future we have. Well, you already have machine translation, automatic machine translation, all that, which are all using neural networks, right? So that's why you focus on this ARM-managed GPU here. So this also, I want to show that it also beats state-of-the-art techniques. So here we do a comparison with the polyhedral compiler, PPCG, and we see this is basically the speedup we get over PPCG. There is just two input size, small and large, we use for each of these benchmarks. This is a different set of benchmarks. So what we did here is that we took this version of the benchmark we already written to be used as an input to the PolyRun compiler. We plugged in an auto tuner. I think it's the open tuner from MIT that we plug in to PPCG and to our code generator as well. And then we give the same amount of time to both systems to search the space. And then we report the best result we get after a maximum of 4 hours of search for each benchmark. And what we see here is that we always are at least higher than PPCG, except in one little case over there. And we get speed up, a huge speed up to 12x on certain benchmarks on certain platforms. That shows you that this approach that we have using rewrite rules rather than something else like behavioral compilation can actually be quite good to generate high-performance code. So I'm arriving to the end of the talk, and unfortunately, as I said, I don't have results to show you for various reasons. We're working with a company, some of these, we have results, but I'm actually not allowed to disclose them yet. What I'm allowed to show is that we are able to express convolution, convolution layer in our system. And this is the expression of how it looks like in our system at the high level, expressed in terms of map, reduce, and zip, and so on, and slide. This is the primitive I mentioned here. This is all we need to express convolution layer of one of the Google Maps network, GPG or ResNet, or any of these networks. And what we do, we take that expression, like matrix multiplication, we give it as an input to our compiler, we let the rewrite works, it's magic, we get a lot of different data points, we run them all, and we find the best version for specific input sizes. And I hope that in a few months I'll be able to share some results. But I can tell you that this approach works. And if you have questions on this, Noam Smotter, my PhD student, was just here. Yeah, he's the one that wrote that crazy expression. So you can ask him how he does it. Okay, so to summarize, what I've shown is that we can use rewrite rules to basically define a search space. And this is nice because these rewrites are basically a formalization of optimization and algorithmic choices that you have. It gives high performance code. We can achieve high performance code, so that's good. In the future direction, well, we want to focus on the search space problem. Up until now, we use horrible heuristic, a lot of randomness, but actually I have a student working on using machine learning to try to tune the search process. Maybe using reinforcement learning or using some performance predictor rather than having